Hey there, welcome back, and welcome to what is the beginning of, I think, our fourth year. We might be jumping in partway through our fourth year of theory. But as some of you may know, sort of, you know, letting you into my world a little bit, I usually spend the summer creating my history lessons for the next school year. And I've decided that this year I'm going to try doing it in a bit of a different format. Instead of doing everything through video editing software, I've decided to make PowerPoints. And you'll see me, and I'm actually going to try to teach you the information that I'm covering here. And hopefully, you know, everything still works out, that the product is just as good, and maybe it feels a little more personal for you because you can see me and it's not just my voice behind a camera. And so that's kind of my thinking here. So I'm excited to try a new format for this set of lessons. We're going to get into the 19th century, and that's where we're going to spend most of our time here. This is sort of the Romantic period. So in sort of the first bit, we're going to talk about Beethoven a little bit. So that's going to take a couple lessons. Then we're going to talk about after Beethoven. We're going to talk about a bunch of different Romantic composers, a little bit about Romantic opera. A whole bunch of topics around the Romantic period this year. Let's start today's episode. This is going to be episode 40, our first episode about Beethoven. So, welcome to today's lesson, where we will embark on a journey into the world of Beethoven's iconic Fifth Symphony. It was composed in 1808. Now, this symphony stands as a testament to Beethoven's revolutionary approach to the music and his ability to evoke powerful emotions within the listener. In this lesson, we will delve into two key aspects of the Fifth Symphony: its motivic consistency and its dramatic progression. Now, Beethoven's Fifth Symphony is renowned for its unique use of motivic development, where a single rhythmic motif serves as the foundation for the entire symphony. We will explore how Beethoven ingeniously manipulates this motive, expanding and transforming it throughout the different movements, creating a sense of unity and organic growth. We will compare Beethoven's approach to motivic technique with that of classical composers like Mozart, discovering how Beethoven's use of the same device takes on a different expressive intensity and serves non-classical ends. Furthermore, we will unravel the dramatic progression that unfolds within the symphony, starting with the gripping urgency of the first movement. We will examine how Beethoven builds tension and introduces a psychological journey for the listener. We will uncover the reoccurring motives and key associations that connect the latter movements to the struggle depicted in the opening movement, leading ultimately to the triumph over fate. By the end of this lesson, you will gain a deeper appreciation for Beethoven's innovative techniques and his ability to captivate audience through motivic consistency and a dramatic progression of emotions. So, let's dive into the world of Beethoven's Fifth Symphony and uncover the remarkable musical and emotional landscapes that await us. Let's go. Now, in the previous lessons that we've had, we explored the music created during the 19th century. Now, this period introduced many renowned composers who left a significant mark on musical history. Some of the notable people we included were Beethoven, Schubert, Schumann, Chopin, Wagner, Verdi, Brahms, Tchaikovsky, Mahler, and others as well. You might be surprised to realize that you're already familiar with some of the tunes from this era, as they often appear as background music in movies, television shows, and even get transformed into popular songs and featured in advertisements. Even today, this music continues to captivate audiences in concert halls, opera houses, classrooms, and music studios. Its enduring appeal rests on the same foundations as it did 100 or even 150 years ago. During the 19th century, music achieved unprecedented recognition as a serious and esteemed art form. Composers were given a new elevated status, and they rose to the occasion, producing music that sounds significant and awe-inspiring. Since then, listeners have been consistently impressed by their compositions. So during the Romantic era, music held a prestigious position mainly because it was believed to be the art form that best reflects one's inner emotional world. It was thought that music had a unique ability to convey personal feelings. Composers rose to this challenge, resulting in 19th century music being more direct and emotionally intense compared to earlier periods. Think way, way, way back. Think back, you know, 3 years ago when we talked about sort of Gregorian chant and church music. And probably for a lot of you, you thought, this is kind of boring. This isn't really what I'm into. We are so far from that right now. And the music of these people in the day was captivating to the listeners. Even exaggerated emotions in music continued to attract and resonate with audiences. In the 19th century, the individuality of artists, including composers, was highly valued. Composers infused their music with pronounced personal characteristics, which was a departure from the more uniform styles of the late Baroque and classical periods. Consequently, when considering the history of 19th century music, it's natural to focus on the great names like the composers mentioned earlier. The prospect of getting to know these distinct, unusual, and fascinating individuals within the emotional context of Romantic music often adds to the appeal of this particular body of music. People are often drawn to specific composers while being less interested in others. For instance, some music lovers might dislike Wagner while cherishing Schubert more than even Beethoven and Bach. Similar to 18th century music, 19th century music isn't stylistically uniform. However, it can still be considered a larger historical period. We will delve into the Romantic style, typically associated with the 1820s, after discussing the music of Beethoven. Now, Beethoven, who was born in 1770 and visited Vienna as a young man to meet Mozart and study with Haydn, he is an essential figure. While Beethoven's technical approach clearly aligned with the 18th century, his emotional intensity, artistic ambition, and emphasis on individuality firmly placed him in the 19th century. In fact, Beethoven served as a direct or indirect inspiration for many of the great composers who followed him in the 19th century. Understanding Beethoven is crucial in grasping the essence of Romantic music. So when Beethoven passed away, he left behind numerous notebooks filled with musical sketches encompassing almost all of his compositions. These sketches varied in size, with larger books kept at home and smaller pocket-sized ones taken along on his walks. They offer us a glimpse into Beethoven's creative process, starting from a simple theme or motive and gradually expanding upon it. He would experiment with different ideas, crossing out the ones that didn't work until he arrived at a complete draft of a song or even entire movement of a symphony. It truly was remarkable that we can trace the entire evolution of a work like Beethoven's Fifth Symphony through these sketches, which often seem to foreshadow the story or emotional journey we experience in the symphony hall. However, it's important to note that these sketches are not neat and orderly. The music struggles to emerge from the chaotic jumble of Beethoven's handwriting. His penmanship, at times, reflects his fury, frustration, and the pains of the creative process. As a result, throughout the 19th century and beyond, those who admire the heroism of Beethoven's music and his life have often perceived a superhuman effort in his sketches, a relentless battle to extract one masterpiece after another from the most ordinary materials, all while facing personal challenges. Beethoven never discarded his sketchbooks. He carried them with him wherever he went, and he moved quite frequently. It seems he regarded them as an integral part of his very existence, inseparable from his being. So maybe let's talk a little bit about Beethoven here for just one second. I'm going to grab a quick sip. So, if there's one composer who deserves a special place in the history of music, it is Ludwig van Beethoven. Few other figures in the art elicit such a universal and powerful response. While people may feel sympathy for Van Gogh, respect Michelangelo and Shakespeare, and admire Leonardo da Vinci, Beethoven immediately evokes a strong and positive image. He is seen as the rugged, unattractive, and impassioned genius who defiantly confronted adversity and produced deeply expressive masterpieces one after another. Beethoven's music has enjoyed enduring popularity, appealing to both casual listeners and the most knowledgeable musicians. Moreover, Beethoven played a crucial role in the maturation of music as an art form. Despite the extraordinary music composed by Bach, Mozart, and others, it was Beethoven's symphonies and sonatas that truly elevated the status of music. They were a revelation to the listeners of his time, who were equally captivated by the details of his life, particularly his deafness, which compelled him to withdraw from performing and focus solely on his composition. During his era, a new concept of artistic genius was taking shape, and Beethoven epitomized this notion in a profound manner. No longer was the artist regarded as a mere craftsman. Instead, the artist experienced suffering and created art. The artist possessed not only exceptional talent, but also a deeper soul than ordinary individuals, creating for the betterment of humanity. Music was no longer seen as a product of physical abilities like hearing or finger dexterity. It flowed from the artist's innermost spirit, reaching the highest realms of creativity. Beethoven holds a special position as a composer due to his unique connection between the Viennese classical style of the 18th century and the emerging Romanticism of the 19th century. Although firmly rooted in the classical tradition, Beethoven was profoundly influenced by his studies under Haydn, who was at the height of his fame during this time. Throughout his life, Beethoven remained devoted to the principles of the classical style. However, while committed to the principles of classicism, Beethoven deviated from certain aspects and, more significantly, I might add, from the underlying mood associated with it. There is an inherent sense of urgency and striving in Beethoven's music that sets it apart from the works of Haydn and Mozart. His compositions can be highly intense, displaying moments of violence, solemnity, severity, or exceptional tenderness. These distinct qualities emerged as a response to the nascent romantic sentiments that will be explored in our upcoming videos. Romanticism, as we will explore further, originated as a literary movement. By the early 19th century, it had gained significant momentum, although its influence in Vienna was still limited. Moreover, Beethoven did not possess a particularly literary sensibility. However, at the core of Romanticism lay a momentous political upheaval that profoundly impacted Beethoven's generation, the French Revolution. Like many artists of the time, Beethoven felt compelled to express his sympathy for the ideals of freedom embodied by this transformative event. In 1789, when the Parisian crowd stormed the Bastille, Beethoven was an impressionable 18-year-old already grounded in liberal and humanistic ideals. In 1803, his admiration for Napoleon Bonaparte as a hero of the revolution led him to embark on an extravagant and unprecedented endeavor, a descriptive symphony initially titled Bonaparte. However, when Napoleon declared himself Emperor of France, causing a shockwave throughout liberal Europe, Beethoven, in a fit of anger, scratched out the dedication on his score. His sentiments towards Napoleon and France were forever altered. Nonetheless, idealism is not easily extinguished. For many, the French Revolution still represented an ideal of perfection, not so much in terms of human society, as Beethoven acknowledged by removing Napoleon's name, but in terms of human aspiration. This ideal was also embodied in Beethoven's own triumph over his deafness, an achievement that was not lost on those swept away by his music during the time. Subsequently, this is what audiences have continued to respond to. When listening to the Eroica Symphony, we can sense that its significance extends beyond Napoleon. It reflects the composer's own self-image, the profound qualities of heroic striving and inner triumph emerge magnificently in Beethoven's most renowned compositions. So here you can see two pictures on the screen. The first one is called Storming the Bastille, and that's a contemporary engraving of the most famous event from the French Revolution. And the other one, we have The Revolution Betrayed, as painted by Jacques-Louis David. After crowning himself emperor, Napoleon then crowns his wife, Josephine, Empress of France in 1904. Today, this huge painting, it's a 20 by 30 foot painting, it repels some viewers almost as much as the actual event it depicts that enraged Beethoven. So as mentioned earlier, Beethoven distinguishes himself from Haydn and Mozart through his exhilarating and urgent mood. He achieved this by pushing the boundaries of various musical elements. He explored the extremes of higher and lower registers, employed sharper syncopations, emphasized stronger accents, incorporated harsher dissonances that ultimately resolved into profound resolutions. These characteristics are prevalent throughout Beethoven's music. He also introduced new demands for instruments expanded the size of the orchestra, and stretched the limits of classical forms. Given these innovations, it's no surprise that Beethoven is particularly associated with the symphony, which is considered the most public and expressive genre in classical music, offering a wide range of emotions, variety, and sheer volume. Interestingly, Beethoven composed fewer symphonies, 9, compared to his piano sonatas, which he wrote 32 of, and string quartets that he wrote 16 of. However, musicians hold his piano sonatas and string quartets in equal regard to his symphonies. During the pinnacle of his career, roughly from 1800 to 1810, even many of his piano sonatas and string quartets exhibit symphonic qualities. The cascades of sound Beethoven conjured in these works necessitated entirely new techniques of piano and string playing. So, Beethoven's life was marked by numerous challenges and personal struggles, but his musical genius and artistic contributions remained timeless. Unlike Mozart, Beethoven experienced a difficult childhood with an alcoholic and abusive father who forced him to practice music. However, he had the opportunity to serve as a court musician in Bonn, where he interacted with aristocrats and was exposed to the ideas of the Enlightenment. At the age of 22, Beethoven received the opportunity to study with Haydn in Vienna. This is where he quickly gained recognition as a virtuoso pianist and composer. He captivated audiences with his own compositions and remarkable improvisations, performing at the palaces of Vienna's music-loving aristocracy. Beethoven settled in Vienna and remained there until his death. Tragically, he began to lose his hearing in his 30s, which profoundly affected his ability to perform as a musician. This crisis led him to contemplate suicide and resulted in the writing of his Heiligenstadt Testament, a document expressing his artistic ideals and personal struggles. However, Beethoven found the strength to overcome his despair and went on to compose his groundbreaking Third Symphony, also known as the Eroica. Eroica, I didn't mention this when it came up earlier, actually translates to heroic. And we mentioned that originally this symphony was written for Napoleon and how he scratched out the title. Something that I didn't mention to you is he actually scratched in a new title, and that was To the Memory of a Great Man. Beethoven sought support from the Viennese nobility, who were impressed by his powerful and original music. As well as his uncompromising character, he was known for his brusque and strong-willed nature and dedicated his life to his art. Beethoven's personal life was tumultuous, characterized by frequent relocations and chaotic domestic arrangements. In his later years, Beethoven became more conservative politically. He experienced a period of decline during the French occupations of Vienna, but ultimately produced some of his greatest works. Unfortunately, much of his music was ahead of its time and not fully appreciated by his contemporaries. Despite his immense need for affection, Beethoven never married, although he had several love affairs. After his death, passionate letters addressed to his immortal beloved were discovered, later identified as the wife of Frankfurt merchant. Beethoven also adopted his nephew, but their relationship was strained, leading the young boy to attempt suicide due to Beethoven's overprotectiveness. Throughout his life, Beethoven battled with ill health, and the added stress of family issues hastened his death. His funeral was attended by thousands, and his eulogy was written by Vienna's leading poet. Beethoven's music has transcended changing tastes and continues to be celebrated by audiences and critics alike. His compositions are renowned for their originality and expressive power, remaining timeless masterpieces. Beethoven's Fifth Symphony, composed in 1808, embodies three distinct features that have captivated listeners for generations: its rhythmic drive, its motivic consistency, and the sense of a definite psychological progression. These elements contribute to the symphony's lasting impact and its status as a musical masterpiece. The symphony's rhythmic drive is immediately apparent. Characterized by its forceful and powerful rhythm, Beethoven emphasizes the meter, stacking accent upon accent, creating a stark contrast to the elegance and wit often associated with the classical style of music. Motivic consistency is another prominent aspect of the Fifth Symphony. Throughout the first movement, a single motive is heard repeatedly in various forms. Dun, 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 dun. These forms are not random, but rather serve to intensify the significance of the motive as the symphony unfolds. Listeners have marveled at the organic quality of the music, and it seems to grow and develop like the leaves of a plant emerging from a simple seed. One of the most striking aspects of the symphony is its sense of psychological progression. Beethoven appears to trace a coherent and dramatic psychological journey across the four movements. He is said to have remarked, "The fate knocks at the door," regarding the first movement. However, after two eventful middle stages, the presence of fate is ultimately negated in the final movement, symbolically defeated by a triumphant military march. In Beethoven's hands, the multi-movement symphony becomes a vehicle for depicting an inspirational life process, one that resonates with listeners on a fundamental and universal level. This innovative approach to the symphonic composition represents one of Beethoven's greatest contributions to the evolution of music. The Fifth Symphony's enduring appeal lies in its ability to engage and move audiences with its rhythmic power, motivic development, and profound psychological narrative. Beethoven's introduction of the scherzo as a replacement for the traditional minuet in his symphonies and other multi-movement works is indeed an important technical innovation. The scherzo, derived from the minuet, is a fast and lively movement in triple meter, typically following the basic ABA structure of the minuet and trio. However, Beethoven's scherzo often exhibits such rapid tempo that they require additional repetitions to effectively convey their musical idea, leading to extending forms such as ABABA. The term scherzo translates to joke in Italian. Beethoven's approach to humor in his scherzo differs significantly from that of the composers like Haydn. His humor is more robust, brusque, and even at times violent. The minuet, associated with the formal and elegant atmosphere of the 19th century, was rejected by Beethoven in favor for the scherzo, which provided an ideal platform for his characteristic rhythmic drive and energetic expression. Beethoven's adoption of the scherzo as a replacement for the minuet showcases his willingness to challenge traditional forms and conventions in music. This innovation further contributes to the distinctiveness and lasting impact of his compositions. I know that this one's a little bit long. I'm pretty sure the next few won't be quite as long. We're going to look at this Symphony No. 5 in C minor by Beethoven. Yes, Beethoven composed his Fifth Symphony and Sixth Symphony, also known as his Pastoral Symphony, around the same time and presented them together at a concert in 1808. This concert, held in Vienna, was a significant event in Beethoven's career as it showcased several of his own compositions. Now, despite the challenging circumstances, such as the concert lasting a remarkable 5 hours and the lack of heating in the hall, the concert was indeed a success. The program featured a variety of works by Beethoven, including premieres of his Fifth and Sixth Symphonies, as well as other compositions such as the Fourth Piano Concerto and selections from the Mass in C major. The concert attracted a considerable audience and marked an important moment in Beethoven's artistic journey, demonstrating his creative prowess and the breadth of his musical output. Despite the unconventional length and the uncomfortable conditions, the concert left a lasting impression and contributed to Beethoven's reputation as a groundbreaking composer in his time. Indeed, the first movement of Beethoven's Fifth Symphony, marked Allegro, con brio, is notable for its strong motivic consistency. The famous rhythmic motive, often referred to as short, 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 long, or dum, 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 permeates the entire movement and plays a central role in its thematic development. The movement opens with this distinctive motive, which serves as the first theme presented in the exposition. It establishes a sense of urgency and sets the energetic tone of the symphony. As the movement progresses, Beethoven manipulates and transforms this motive in various ways, exploring its rhythmic and melodic possibilities. During the bridge section, the motive continues to be prominent, linking different thematic materials and adding cohesion to the overall structure. Even when a contrasting second theme is introduced, the rhythmic motive can be heard in the background, subtly underscoring the lyrical and melodic elements. As the movement reaches its cadence, the motive returns in full force, creating a powerful and dramatic culmination. The repetition and intensification of the motive in the cadence heighten the sense of tension and release, showcasing both Beethoven's mastery of building musical momentum. By employing the single rhythmic motive throughout the movement, Beethoven achieves a remarkable unity and coherence. The motive serves as a unifying thread, connecting different sections and themes and contributing to the overall dramatic impact of the symphony. You are correct that both Mozart and Beethoven employ motivic development in their compositions. In Mozart's Symphony No. 40, for example, a single motive is developed consistently throughout the work. However, Beethoven's use of motivic technique in the Fifth Symphony differs in terms of its expressive intensity and the ends to which it's employed. In classical music, including Mozart's works, motivic development often serves to showcase the composer's skill and craftsmanship. The development of a motive is approached in a more systematic and structured manner, with a focus on balance, symmetry, and the logical progression of musical ideas. While there may be emotional and dramatic elements in classical music, they are generally contained within the framework of the established conventions of the style. In the Fifth Symphony, on the other hand, the motivic technique is used with a heightened sense of expressiveness and urgency. The repetitive and relentless nature of this motive, dum 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 dum, creates a sense of tension and forward drive, evoking a feeling of struggle and intensity. Beethoven takes the motive and expands it further in the development section and the extended coda, exploring its potential for growth and transformation. The difference lies in the way Beethoven pushes the boundaries of the motivic technique and employs it to serve non-classical ends. He infuses the motive with a sense of emotional depth, existential turmoil, and even a sense of fate or destiny. The motive becomes a musical embodiment of the human spirit grappling with the challenges and seeking truth over adversity. By utilizing this motivic technique in a more expressive and intense manner, Beethoven creates a gripping and powerful experience for the listener. The Fifth Symphony stands as a prime example of his ability to infuse traditional forms with his own unique vision and emotional depth, transcending the boundaries of the classical style and paving the way for the Romantic era that follows. In the exposition of the Fifth Symphony, the movement opens with a striking presentation of the first theme in C minor. The use of fermatas, indicated by the fermata symbol, disrupts the meter and creates a sense of improvisation and primal energy. These fermatas, which imply an indefinite hold on the notes, contribute to the dramatic and intense character of the music. The theme surges forward, building momentum, but is abruptly halted by another fermata, creating a sense of tension and anticipation. The bridge section, often serving as a transitional passage in a symphonic movement, takes on a particularly dramatic role in this symphony. It is introduced by a horn call, which acts as a bridge between the initial key of C minor and the new key, usually a major key, that will lead to the second theme. The horn call serves to firmly establish the key and prepares for the entrance of the second theme with heightened intensity. The second theme contrasts with the first theme, introducing a gentle and lyrical mood. Despite the underlying presence of the main motive rumbling in the background, this new mood is short-lived as Beethoven quickly dismisses it. If impatient with its delicate nature, the main motive returns in a stormy cadence passage accompanied by a sense of turbulence and power. This passage builds up to a satisfying and conclusive stop, providing a strong sense of closure to the exposition. In the symphony's structure, the exposition is typically repeated to reinforce the musical ideas presented. This repetition allows the listener to become more familiar with the themes, the motives, and the harmonic progression introduced in the opening section of this movement. In the development section of Beethoven's Fifth Symphony, a new eruption occurs as the first theme undergoes clear modifications, returning to the minor mode. This modulation is emphasized by yet another fermata, creating a dramatic and ominous effect reminiscent of a crack of doom. During this section, the continuation of the first theme is developed, leading to a climax where the rhythm represented by this pattern we see here intensifies rapidly. This heightened rhythmic intensity adds to the tension and energy of the music. Following this bridge, the theme from the exposition enters, and it modulates through a series of different keys. Suddenly, the two middle pitches of the bridge theme are isolated and echoed between the high winds and instruments and lower strings. This technique is known as fragmentation, where a musical idea is broken down into smaller fragments or snippets. As the two-note figure continues to fragment further, the echoing process eventually reduces to just one note, creating a sense of fragmentation. This development section showcases Beethoven's skill in transforming and manipulating musical material. Through modulation, rhythmic intensification, and fragmentation, he explores different tonalities, textures, and expressive possibilities, adding depth and complexity to the overall musical narrative. Indeed, Beethoven was a master of creating tension and suspense in the retransitions, which are sections in sonata form that lead to the recapitulations. In the Fifth Symphony, the tension reaches its peak during these retransition passages, creating an almost unbearable hush and anticipation. As the retransition unfolds, the entire orchestra seems to grab the listener's attention and shake them by the lapels. The main motive of the symphony represented by the iconic dum-dum-dum-dum rhythm, is repeated forcefully and relentlessly. This repetition adds to the sense of urgency and intensity, building up the climactic moment. Finally, the first theme, which was initially presented in a different key, settles back into the original tonic key, providing a sense of resolution and completion. This return to the tonic key marks the arrival of the recapitulation, where the main themes of the movement are restated with some variation and modification. Beethoven's skill in manipulating tension and using repetition to create a sense of emotional impact is evident in this section of the Fifth Symphony. The powerful and relentless statement or relentless restatement of the main motive serves to heighten the dramatic effect and capture the listener's attention, leading to the culmination of the retransition and the subsequent return to the familiar thematic material. In the recapitulation of Beethoven's Fifth Symphony, first movement, Beethoven follows a traditional classical structure, staying close to the material presented in his exposition. However, he incorporates a notable addition during the third fermata, which provides a moment of contrast and expressive beauty. Instead of maintaining the same structure as this exposition, Beethoven takes the opportunity to insert a solo oboe passage in free rhythm. This passage acts as a kind of cadenza, allowing the oboe to shine and provide a temporary departure from the relentless rhythmic drive of the main theme. It introduces a slower and more expressive section, offering a brief respite and a chance for the listener to savor a different musical character. The extraordinary moment showcases Beethoven's ability to infuse his compositions with unexpected and captivating elements. While the overall structure of this recapitulation remains faithful to classical conventions, this particular addition demonstrates Beethoven's willingness to push the boundaries and add his own unique touch to the composition. It serves as a testament to his creativity and ability to create moments of emotional depth and contrast within the framework of a classical symphonic form. Now, in the coda of the Fifth Symphony's first movement, Beethoven demonstrates his departure from classical formulas and inclination towards innovative and unconventional compositional techniques. The coda's section diverges from the expected resolution and introduces a new contrapuntal idea, deviating from the typical classical cadential patterns. Instead of providing a straightforward resolution to the musical tension built up throughout the movement, Beethoven introduces a new contrapuntal theme or idea that adds further complexity and intensity to the composition. This departure from the expected classical cadence and resolution showcases willingness to experiment with musical structure and push the boundaries of traditional form. By introducing the new contrapuntal idea in the coda, Beethoven extends the musical journey and prolongs the sense of tension and urgency, defying the conventions of classical composition. This unconventional approach reflects Beethoven's desire to create a composition that is emotionally powerful and intellectually stimulating, breaking away from the established norms of the time. The coda of the Fifth Symphony's first movement exemplifies Beethoven's mastery in manipulating musical elements and his ability to create a sense of drama and excitement through unexpected twists and turns. It is a testament to his unique artistic vision and his determination to forge his own path in the realm of classical music. In the coda of the Fifth Symphony first movement, he juxtaposes the bottom contrapuntal line with the first theme, creating an interesting musical comparison. The four main theme notes, G, E flat, F, and D, are played in the rhythm of the bridge theme, resulting in G, 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 E flat, F, 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 D, becoming G, 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 E flat, F, D. The rhythmic transformation allows for a connection between the two themes. The two middle notes, E flat and F, which serve as a common ground between the themes, are then emphasized by a transcending sequence. This sequence evolves into a somber, march-like passage in the minor mode, providing a moment of respite from the continuous thematic developments of the main motive. It introduces a contrasting texture and mood to the composition. Following this march-like passage, there is a final, defined appearance of the original theme, which then leads to continuations that unexpectedly evoke a poignant emotional response. These continuations deviate from the energetic and forceful nature of the main motive, adding a touch of vulnerability and depth to the musical narrative. However, the movement concludes with affirmative cadences once again built upon the main motive. This return to the familiar and assertive cadences brings the movement to a powerful and conclusive ending, reaffirming the dominance and significance of the main motive throughout the composition. The juxtaposition and evolution of the contrapuntal line and the first theme in the coda exemplify Beethoven's ability to manipulate musical elements and create contrasting emotions within a unified musical structure. It showcases his skill in incorporating different thematic materials and transforming them to create a dramatic and impactful musical experience. In the later movements, Beethoven continues to explore and respond to the tension established in the first movement, leading to a resolution and sense of triumph. The presence of the rhythmic motive from the first movement, that short, 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 long, serves as a recurring motive throughout the symphony, reminding listeners of the initial move and creating a sense of unease and anticipation. Additionally, the key of the first movement, C minor, plays a significant role in the later movements as well. Whenever the symphony returns to this key, whether it's in the original minor mode or the major mode, it evokes associations with the struggle that Beethoven himself linked to fate knocking at the door. The minor mode recalls the tension and conflict, while the major mode signifies or foreshadows the ultimate resolution and triumph over fate. By incorporating these elements, Beethoven creates a sense of continuity and development across the movements of the symphony. The subsequent movements can be seen as responses to the struggles and tensions introduced in the first movement, leading to a climactic resolution in the final movement. This dramatic progression and thematic unity contribute to the overall impact and emotional power of the Fifth Symphony. So, with that, let's listen to the very first movement of Beethoven's Symphony No. 5. Thank you. Wow. What a great opening movement. So that finishes up our first long episode about Beethoven. I promise, I believe, the next one will not be quite as long. We're going to move into the second and third movements of this, and then get into the fourth movement as well to finish off thinking about Beethoven. So, until next time, have a great week, and we'll see you later.